answer any questions you may have.
While I've got you, Steve.
Yeah.
You were talking about high speed internet?
Yeah.
Be sure to ride by the old Fort Hill building.
Yes.
Where they're putting the tier three data storage facility there. 10 million watts will be running through that first. That's a lot of juice. So the high speed internet phase of what you're talking about will kind of happen through the development of that, because it's going to open up a lot more service opportunity for this area. So
great, yeah, I've seen that being fixed up, and it's a great location. Couldn't be more central. Or maybe they can bring it over to Green Magnet, first things first, and over to Austin Homes, and, you know.
It's being discussed.
Yeah, that would be great.
I have to say, personally, I have a single vote. Mm-hmm. I could vote for her. She sold me that much tonight. I could vote for you.
Thank
That's
you.
A good thing. Until someone shakes that, you're in good shape. And this is true.
Yeah.
In this part of the process, I don't know. But what I've heard so far, she's got the chops for it. She does have the ability to do this job. So, any questions that anyone has? Mr. Beal? And then David?
With all the needs of the city that are going on, whether that fixing the potholes or street lights or whatever's going on, with the balance of trying to keep a lid on the budget, it seems like you're having to sharpen that pencil more and more and more. What's your outlook of how to do that, how to make that balance work?
Well, luckily we've, in recent years, had a very strong economy, and so I would certainly want to continue support, you know, having whatever it takes to, you know, I sort of feel like the city's job to support a strong economy is to make sure that infrastructure is there for private investment. It's not our job to open a grocery store, but can we make a neighborhood so nice that it's got the streetlights and the sidewalks and, you know, good law enforcement and parks, so people want to move there, and then the people have the money to buy the groceries, so the grocery store will move in. So I think the way to balance the budget is to have a strong economy, and that, you know, is, you know, not easier said than done, and a local city municipal government has some levers to help in that regard, but I mean, we're not the Federal Reserve or anything like that, so we'll do what we can. And I think being able to be a strong supportive partner to the school board, and, you know, because one thing when businesses are looking to move here or to expand here, the first question they ask is there an educated workforce ready to be hired? And the answer to that is yes, sometimes, but sometimes you're going to need to invest a little bit more in your new hires to train them up. And, you know, that's okay. I mean, and sometimes, you know, sometimes maybe they're ready, it just it varies. But so investing in our people and having, you know, the infrastructure so people want to move here. If the people want to move here, then the businesses will too, because that's who their employees are. So that's, hopefully that answers the question a little bit.
David.
You had a statement about not wanting to tear up older neighborhoods. That's kind of a good core of it. I'm sort of a link between my neighborhood from the past and present and future.
Mm-hmm.
Things like mixed use, the way it worked on Southern Hotspur, that is really great for today. And if we could utilize those concepts of work in the past, but each neighborhood, like you said, a little bit different from other neighborhoods, there's some things where they're the same, but that was a very favorable comment you made. Respecting things of the past, they're not going to tear up an old neighborhood and so forth.
Yeah, I'm live in an older part of town, and it is sort of funny what is old is new again. Like, some of the things we have in older parts of town is what they're trying to recreate, even at like North Shore Town Center. You know, walkability, have a little grocery store, you know, you can walk to your school, you know that still exists in some parts of town, and other parts of town are trying to go back to it, so yeah, I'm a fan.
Growing up, we built the promenade in 1960 as a kid. I loved the escalator. Mm-hmm. We'd like to do that on Southern, on the businesses, and several mm-hmm. blocks in the back, open mm-hmm. up like a nature area, benches and so forth, and have some things that would illustrate the history of the neighborhood.
That would be mm-hmm.
I'm encouraged by your comments.
I want to throw you to the real estate man.
Okay.
Old St. Mary's campus, mm-hmm. East Town Mall. Mm-hmm. Just give me your feeling about, give me your creative idea about East Town Mall, and then tell me if you go along with, I'm sure you feel good about the mayor's plan to use that for the police and fire, but just because it would be a part of your administration to implement that.
Absolutely.
Just go ahead and give that a whirl.
Well, there are a lot of things that Mayor O'Hara has started and is not going to be able to finish, and that's okay. I mean, you don't want to have everything tied up neatly because that means you're not ambitious enough. I think there are a lot of things that she has started that I would be, hopefully, if elected, around to implement. And St. Mary's, the new police headquarters and firefighter headquarters and the city court would be part of that. As a longtime resident of North Knoxville, I'm really sad that they closed the hospital there. That would be my first choice, to have it stay as a hospital, because we need, I mean, across the state, hospital closures are really bad. And that's a national and state problem, and we, the city, can't fix that alone. But since it's closed down as a hospital, it's already closed as of December 31st, I think I do support the idea of having the, I think we do need a new headquarters for police and fire, and that seems to be a good way forward, because I also know from being, no neighborhood wants a huge property just to sit there empty and fester. We don't need another, like, Standard Knitting Mill, for example, just sitting there empty and blighted for years and years. So I support that. I understand, I can't remember all the particulars, but that the city, the police and fire headquarters would take up some of the space, and the courtroom would be maybe in a new construction, but then the older part of St. Mary's might still, there might be part of it that still has room for maybe some kind of emergency clinic. I think there's always an existing need for more medical care, so maybe that could be part of it. I do think, and I don't know if St. Mary's location used to have this, but I mean, we're in desperate need for mental health care facilities. I mean, that's not something the city can run, but if the city can work with state and federal and county partners and nonprofits to find a location to have, I mean, for example, St. Mary's used to be the only place in the county, the several county area, for long-term behavioral health treatment, where it's like a month stay. And now the closest is in Chattanooga. So that's a big problem. I'm not sure how to solve that, but I know it's an acute problem. So St. Mary's, I support continuing it as a safety center for the headquarters of the police and fire. And if there's extra room, I'm open to suggestions. I'm not sure what kind of space it is, if it's office or whatever. Easttown Mall, also known as Knoxville Center Mall, but everyone around here calls it Easttown Mall because that's what its name was. It's a beautiful facility. I used to shop there pretty frequently. There's not too many shops there anymore. I was really proud when we opened Kelly Volunteer Academy there, named after my predecessor on the school board, Kelly Academy. It's now moved to Lincoln Park. It's a great, great school. But it's not the school in the mall anymore. But one of the reasons, I asked why they moved, and one of the reasons is the current property owners jacked up the rent a lot. So they're having trouble getting tenants, and they're raising the rent because they have a lot of vacancies. It's a vicious circle, and the city only has so much control over private property owners. So I'm not sure how to move forward on that, but I do know that it should, to have it just declining over time is not a healthy thing. So I guess, if I'm lucky enough to be elected, I would like to work with the property owner and talk to them and see if they're, what is it that they're looking for? Would they sell? And for, would they sell at a reasonable price to, and to whom? To someone who has the idea and financial wherewithal to adopt it for a new reuse. And the abandoned malls are an issue all over the country. We're not alone in that. Some malls, Westtown Mall seems to be thriving, but a lot of retail shopping is A, going to the internet, and B, turning into more, people either want a downtown environment or like a Turkey Creek big box shopping environment. So I've read a little bit about some creative reuses for these beautiful indoor spaces. One example that I visited recently wasn't a mall, but it was a big Sears manufacturing warehouse. It's in Memphis called Crosstown Concourse. Mm-hmm. You been there?
Mm-hmm. I love
it. It's beautiful. It's like a million square feet. It's really big. It used to be a processing plant for Sears, all for the whole Mid-South or something. And then it was vacant for 20 years. And now it was a public-private partnership. It has a school in there. It has their equivalent of like a YMCA with a gym. I don't know what it's called. It has some housing, some condos. It also has retail. It has a grocery store. It has art space. It's got a little bit of everything, and it's beautiful. And I don't know how that was financed. I think some angel investors came, you know, who were maybe looking to break even, not make money. But it was very inspirational. I've been there twice now, and it's like a place to go visit and shop and eat and maybe live and visit too. So anyhow.
I've got a question for you.
Yeah.
And this is one of those personnel succession questions. Will you be retaining the services of my good friend, Dr. Michelle Foster?
Sure.
Okay.
I
wanted to throw this out. And this is also an opportunity for you to get ideas from us. I can tell you that my good friend, Dr. Dan, with ET, it's a dream. But I hope that UT would take over Easttown Mall, beat the owners down, get a good price, and create something along the lines of the, is it Thousand Oaks in Nashville? That they converted a mall that was called Thousand Oaks into a medical facility. Mm-hmm. And it has offices and diagnostics and shops, and I mean, it's a really neat concept. If, as you said, someone with wherewithal could go in, mm-hmm. take that property over with a vision, we had the resources to turn that around, that would be an excellent use for that facility. Still hope that makes something happen.
That seems like a really good idea, because unlike retail, medical services you can't do online. You know, you have to, at least most of them, you have to have in-person people helping you, therapies, whatever. So, yeah, that I love that idea, finding the people to execute it.
You mentioned in passing Airbnb,
mm-hmm.
and that is a very hot button topic in some communities, and there are a lot of different perspectives on it. The owner wants to rehab his place and make a little money, mm-hmm. but the neighbors are going crazy. What's your perspective on it?
My perspective is that the ordinance that the city adopted, it's just been in place about a year, so I'd like to give it a chance to work, and I think some of the provisions I put in there will protect neighborhoods from going to like all Airbnb. I mean, I think that was a concern that neighborhood. I actually lived across the street from an Airbnb in Fourth and Gill. They weren't licensed. They were doing it, you know, off the books or whatever. And it wasn't a problem. I mean, it wasn't a problem. Like, they never had bad guests or anything. But it was sort of weird to live next to that instead of like neighbors. And so I get that there are pros and cons to it. You know, at the same time, the people who own that property, you know, they could make a little extra money. But they would no longer be allowed to do that. It now was bought by a family and occupied by people who just live there in their neighborhood. But I think now it has to be owner-occupied. And so that makes a big difference. So it's not just, you still do have neighbors, and then the neighbors just have guests a lot. And you're supposed to apply for a permit and, you know, that sort of thing, and I think so.
You have to have a license.
You have to have a license,
and you have to have a business permit.
Okay.
And then you also pay the taxes on that.
Right. So it's a more level playing field with
yes.
Hotels. Or,
yeah. And they eliminated all this year. They have eliminated all of the non-owner occupied.
Okay.
So they were grandfathered in for the year, and now they are converting back to
mm-hmm.
Full-time rentals.
Good.
So
well, I would like to see you. Like I said, so I think the ordinance is good. I'd like to make sure this enforcement is happening. Because one of the biggest effects is not just on other residents around, but it takes away, in some cases, rental properties. And we have a severe shortage of so many more people. 53% of people in Knoxville are renters. And rents have gone up, and almost every property owner I've talked to who owns or manages an apartment building, they're like 100% occupancy with a waiting list. You know, it's really hard to find good, safe, affordable places to live. So when someone converts their property, you know, that was a rental and turns it into Airbnb, you know, that's also another impact that can, you know, have some downsides. So I hope the ordinance is working, and maybe in maybe we'll get a report from the city and see what's happening. Have you had an experience, pro or con?
We've just been to neighborhood meetings, not our neighborhood, but other neighborhoods where there's been a lot of, it's been very sensitive, I would say.
Yeah.
I have a question for you. This will take us into, I guess, traffic engineering. A lot of areas in East Knoxville now have these white stencils, bicycle stencils in the street. And a couple of people have asked me, well, when this new law or legislation goes into effect, where you have to be so far away from a bicycle as it's going down the road, that's a broad concern. But Riverside has always been a throughway of commerce, trucks, large trucks, but now the bike stencils are on that thoroughfare. Mm-hmm. What has started to happen is the trucks that have decided to take a safe way, the path of least resistance and the safest route, to take side streets when they're getting from one spot to the other to avoid that stretch of Riverside. And so my question for you is, are you married to these stencils all over different areas of town, designated them as bike thoroughfares, and are you familiar with the law that will be on the books about?
Yes, I am familiar with that. I am an advocate for all kinds of transit in cars, buses, bikes, walking. Different people have different modes they prefer to get around, and also different people have access. Some people don't have access to cars or can't drive for whatever reason. So I support bike lanes in general, and bike safety makes sense on all roads. I don't know. I mean, one of the problems is when it's a bike lane, it's created just with a line of paint. It's not really that safe for the biker or the cars. You know, it's not a protected barrier. So I don't know if there's, you know, I'm not that familiar with that particular. I haven't seen those bike lanes. I've been on that road, but I guess not recently enough that I saw the bike lanes.
Yeah, they're, you know, it looks like.
How far east?
Oh, it's the span from, I guess, James White Parkway. It's the span of Riverside that the trucks use to get to. And so then what they're doing is they're zipping through Wilder. Mm-hmm. And by the time they started running past Diane Jordan's house,
Well, that sounds like a good conversation to have with the people, you know, the businesses that are having the trucks go back and forth and saying, you know, please use the road that is not through neighborhoods for that. And also, you know, I don't know how narrow or wide it is, well, or how many bikes are on it.
The specifics aren't probably as important as the concept.
Yeah. So the concept, I support biking. Mm-hmm. I also, you know, I support not having big trucks go to neighborhoods. So I think
there's a compromise there. So
yeah, I think there is. I mean, I can't imagine at this point in time there's like a ton of bike traffic on that road all the time. You know, like
there is. But when you see a bike there, you think, oh my gosh, you're taking your life in your hands. The truck's going.
That's
so you're always concerned about that.
Right.
It's just a good thing. I know by now there are a couple more questions. We'll go 1, 2, 3.
I have a short preamble.
Okay.
For my question. It's a housing question. We're not Nashville, but we are growing. And people have to have a place to live. And on my neighborhood, for example, just on my block, there's probably at least 3 houses undergoing reconstruction, one of them older neighborhood.
Which neighborhood?
Park Ridge. And these houses, when they get done, they're gonna look great. And it'd be a great place for somebody to live. They're adjacent to downtown, a lot of pluses.
Sure, you're preamble.
Okay. At the same time, 5 years ago, there were a lot of residents there, low-income people who can't afford to be there anymore. Mm-hmm. So the question is, what ideas do you have that the city can do to help the housing crunch, particularly for lower-income people? Mm-hmm.
This is the issue I hear most about across the city is affordable housing and homelessness. So it's a good question, and some of my ideas are that we could maybe pursue a land trust, like so cities, you know, any land that comes into the city through blight or, you know, tax sales or whatever, could the city could make sure those stay in an affordable way, either rental or to a first-time home buyer. Another idea that I've seen used in other cities, I can't think of which ones at the moment, but when an area is getting investment like that, private investment, that can be really healthy and good, like particularly if they're fixing up blighted properties or building in vacant lots that were just empty. But you don't want to push out the low-income renters. So some of these cities have offered home buying classes and like loan funds that help low-income or renters save, you know, learn what the process is to buy a home and then also save money towards a down payment. So those are some measures. I support the Affordable Housing Fund that helps bridge the financing gap. You know, there are some private investors who build, you know, low-income housing, and it's gotten less lucrative in recent years because of the cost of building materials and just the cost of building. So the city has been, and I would certainly want to support continuing to do this, bridging those gaps, but with the contingencies attached. Like there's money, you give the loans out, but you have the strings attached, which are it has to be affordable for 20 years, 25 years, or something like that. So those are some of the ideas. Also, I'd like to consider budget availability, expanding. The city has some programs to help people rehab existing homes to make them more livable. And if you get those grant, you know, I think it's called home builders. I can't remember some of the others. Some are for homeowners and some are for renters in rental properties to rehab those. So the biggest need is more units of rental housing, because like you said, some are being converted. My house was 1-6 apartments. It's now just me. We have our house and we rent out an apartment on our third floor. I mean, that was in the 80s, so it wasn't that recent, but that's happening in Park Ridge now too. Places that maybe were 6 or 3 apartments are now going back to 1, and maybe, so that is displacement. But maybe some people can also be building on new, you know, creating new ones at the same time. So I hope that RICO can be one vehicle for that too, where it allows duplexes and triplexes in places that are zoned, that can happen by right, and you wouldn't have to do special review. So that could reduce the cost for developers to build more affordable rentals. So RICO will help continue the Affordable Housing Fund. As far as the homelessness, which is a related issue, I support the Housing First approach and also support building more permanent supportive housing like Mandela Manor and Funnikin Landing. And again, that would not be just a city project, that would have to be with the county. Everyone who's homeless in Knoxville is also a county resident. So we gotta work together with our county leaders and also the nonprofit sector. I think the Knoxville Leadership Foundation is the operating arm of Funnikin Landing, for example. And I think VMC runs Mandela Manor. So those are working really well, but there's a lot of long way left to get in, so.
Two more questions, I think, and then school board member Sanford has an announcement as well, correct?
Can you tell us what your vision is to address the opioid problem that we have here in our community?
Well, it is a really big challenge, and I've had, you know, we all know people who have experienced loss or, you know, suffering from this problem. So I guess my vision for it is to treat drug addiction as a disease and public policy issue rather than a moral failing. I think we need to, so what, that's the first step. It's and then look at evidence-based programs that work. You know, what does that mean? You know, does that mean intervention at the street level? Does that mean more treatment centers? We definitely need more treatment centers. So I would like to work with, if I'm elected, County Mayor Jacobs and our state delegation and our federal delegation to get money to support more treatment centers and also to support entities like the Metro Drug Coalition because they work a lot on education and, you know, and also little things that seem little, but like educating people what to do when you have a few leftover pills in your prescription. Don't leave it in the medicine cabinet. Go dispose of it every year. Those, maybe, I don't know how often they happen, but.
You don't encourage me selling them on the street.
So, and from what I've learned a little bit, also, like, it is a law enforcement issue. I'm glad that our KPD officers all have Narcan and know how to use it. I think there are private sector nonprofits that are distributing Narcan kits to people who have friends or are themselves using drugs. So you got to save their lives first, and then, you know, offer them education and treatment. I mean, prevention is the best, but once people get hooked, you know, treatment is the best way forward. And unfortunately, it usually takes many go rounds to have it work. Like, treatment doesn't work the first time. Usually, I think it takes an average of like 6 or 7 attempts before people can really get off. It's very, very addictive drugs. I think we need to work with our medical community, our law enforcement community, and just everybody working together to get the resources and also to destigmatize it, so it's not seen as something that is a willpower thing. It's not. It's more than that.
Yes, you're absolutely right about that. Ms. Williams, do you have a question?
I did. I thought there was someone else before me.
No, we just did it. And if you can do your question, we'll get an answer, and we'll get everybody, and we almost will get out of here right at time.
One of them you covered. I was wanting to ask a question about the homeless population, or your plans or views or consideration for how to handle that going forward. But I will ask the question. My third question would have been, how do you feel about public funds being given to private entities and large businesses for tax incentive and such purposes?
Like TIFs and pilots? Is that what you're talking about? Public subsidies for
say for example, what happened with Regal?
Okay.
Where they were given the $25 million to move into the Baptist Hospital location and sold the property to a Japanese firm 30 days later. And then, of course, we have Jet Dance getting a large incentive to fix up the Cal Johnson building downtown that he privately owns and has on forever. So I'm just,
Yeah, well, I don't know the particulars of
large corporations that are for profit are being given public funds.
Well, I'm against corporate welfare, for sure. And to the extent that a project is just lining the pockets of big business, I'm opposed to it. If there is a community benefit, if there's going to be long-term gain in revenues that benefit the community, that may not come in 5 or 10 years, but come in 15 years, then I guess I'm open to suggestion, but I would like to carefully scrutinize any of those deals that come before us, if I'm mayor, and look at it with a lot of skepticism. You know, we don't need to use public funds to just give away to people to make money. However, you know, there are some reasons that they've worked well in the past because people weren't investing, and so would it help promote a project of revitalization that otherwise wouldn't happen? Maybe there's a role there, but I think that's happened a lot downtown, and sometimes it's been successful, but downtown's already pretty well on its way, so I think the bar is much higher now. So I'm against corporate welfare, but I also want to see the community benefit. So I think it would be up to the proposer to prove to the mayor and city council that the benefit to the community outweighs the cost. You know, the public benefit versus the public cost. So I want to tally that up, and if the public benefit outweighs the cost, then I think it'd be worth it, but if that makes sense. So no corporate welfare, yes to public benefit.
I can assure you that question is going to come up a lot. And I'll have it on the index cards as well. And again, your answer to this question is going to be shaped by what happens in the next several months. Give you a perfect example, Knoxville Salvage Area. Mr. Boyd's going to get a ball field there. To make that happen, he will have to have a payment in lieu of taxes. It just is what it is. And there are folks in this room that can explain to you the mechanics of that, how that happens. But that is going to play out in this election process. Those questions are going to come up. India's answers are going to be similar to what she gave you tonight, because that's what she feels. But her feeling about specific projects will change as the project develops. So your question is an excellent one, and we'll be staying tuned for your answer on that, because they're going to come. You've been an excellent speaker.